Before I say anything else, I would like to point out that these tests were conducted because I was curious. That's it. There's nothing else to it. There's no rhyme or reason behind it other than the fact that I wanted to see what would happen when I severely underclocked my 5820K. I don't recommend doing this. It wouldn't make much sense. Apart from power consumption decline, a much cooler system, and a much quieter one as a result, there is absolutely no reason why you should drop your CPU frequency down to 1.2 GHz or thereabouts. Doesn't matter what processor you're sporting, what CPU cooler you're using, just don't do it. Why did I do it, you ask?
Whoa. Wait. Yeah, that did it. Yeah, bitch! Magnets! Oh!
What you're about to see is a side-by-side comparison between a 5820K running at 1.2 GHz and 0.8 volts, that was the lowest I could drop the voltage without the computer refusing to boot up, and the same CPU running at 4.6 GHz and 1.32 volts. With a minimal graphics card bottleneck, how large of a frame rate disparity will we see in modern AAA titles? Let's start off first with a few synthetics. I ran Ida 64 first to check temps and make sure both clocks were stable. On the left is the underclocked run, the right the overclocked one. Our temps literally did not change during the extent of our underclocked run, something I suppose shouldn't be too surprising given the voltage applied, but it's still surreal to see an X99 CPU running at this temperature under load. On the other hand, the overclock scenario yielded temperatures that were extremely uncomfortable. The voltage applied was perfectly fine and stable, but the 240mm AIO I was using just couldn't dissipate heat quick enough, even with its pump and fans at their max RPMs. For the record, I run the CPU at 1.31 volts and 4.5 GHz for this very reason. Next up was Cinebench R15, and as you can probably tell, the underclock test resulted in a huge CB score cut, almost 75%. By the time the test finally finished, we managed a mere 317, something even my Q6600 laughs at. Geekbench mirrored these findings, roughly 70% cut for the 1.2 GHz run in this case. Something worth mentioning here is how drastically the multi-core score changed compared to that of the single core. When you have more overclockable cores at your disposal, overall performance can significantly jump. It's what makes the X99 chipset so appealing, but only if the games and programs being used are able to take advantage of the core surplus. Now let's throw a few games at the severely underclocked beast. Is it even a beast if it's running at 1.2 GHz? The answer is a big fat no. Check out this side-by-side comparison of the GTA 5 benchmark. There is an enormous frame rate disparity, and we can analyze it in two different ways. The first is from a simple minimum and average frame rate bar graph. 135 versus 48 frames per second on average is a stellar representation of how important CPU frequency is to a degree. But there's another way we can look at this. Frame times. Instead of looking at this in terms of frames per second, let's try milliseconds per frame. In this case, we're looking for a flat and consistent line with minimal spikes. The 1.2 GHz run was all over the place and finishes quicker because fewer frames were drawn overall. The 4.6 GHz run is a very flat and linear line, devoid of spikes. This is exactly what we want to see, a good indicator of a well-balanced system for this game. I'm running two GTX 1070s in SLI, by the way, so GPU bottlenecking should be minimal. The only game on our list that's not properly SLI optimized is City Skylines, explained and verified right here. But even with only one GPU breaking a sweat, it was the CPU that held us back, substantially. Both the average and minimum frame rates were utterly disappointing for the 1.2 GHz chip. 19 FPS on average wouldn't even cut it in the console sphere, And check out that minimum, 7 single digits. Let's move on. How about a GPU-bound title? In the video I pointed to a bit earlier, we verified that Witcher 3 on ultra settings is a graphics card hog, maxing out both 1070s consistently. In this scenario, however, the CPU's abysmal frequency played far too great a role in frame rate reduction. These disparities aren't the worst we've seen thus far, but it's important to note that even GPU-bound titles can be CPU-bound in the right situations. Lastly, we have Battlefield 1, not a title I expected to perform as well as it did, frankly. You're looking at a side-by-side comparison here. Can you tell which is which? In this instance, Battlefield's craving cores over clocks, something I expect will become the norm by the turn of the decade. DirectX 12 and Vulkan will accelerate this trend, but for now, Battlefield 1 remains one of the few games demanding more than 4 cores, in which case, the lower frequency isn't as pivotal. It's still clearly lower the overall frame rate, but not by the degree I expected it to. To keep this one short and sweet, don't do what I did. There is absolutely no point. don't buy a locked Xeon running at 1. Whatever gigahertz, and don't limit yourself to locked SKUs in general if you're certain your graphics card can pull its own weight. If you thought this video was interesting, give it a thumbs up, give it a thumbs down. If you feel the complete opposite, or if you hate everything about life, be sure to click that subscribe button if you haven't already. I'll catch you in the next video. This is Salazar Studio. Thanks for learning with us.